What was I saying? Yeah, just holding them accountable, just like we hold each other accountable. Back to your report, you can't really fix something that's not broken. So I will correct my consumer report. That's why I say that. You know, I'm just correcting my consumer report because y'all got me messed up. So the reason I'm able to, you know, have success with this is because I do handwrite the letters, and I handwrite the letters because when you handwrite letters, it pretty much increases your chances of bypassing their little automatic system, their automated system that will send you an automated response saying this account has been verified. Where? How? Boy, if you don't get me out this automated system and stop playing with me. So it's basically a matter of making sure that your letter gets to a physical being, and that physical being can read it and do what they need to do. And even if they don't do what they need to do, y'all, you send them an initial letter asking them to please provide you with the full account documentation. If they send you back a statement, that is not the full account documentation. A statement ain't nothing. I can send you a statement. I can easily send Deja a statement saying, Deja, you owe me $30. I can make a copy of it and send it to Deja, and that's my statement. She don't owe me nothing. And that's not proof that we actually went into a contract. So, again, just to recap, the credit reporting agencies are supposed to be conducting an extensive investigation before they report anything on your behalf. I don't care if it's your first name. They need to be, you know, looking at your social security card, your birth certificate. They need to be, you know, doing these things. Also, what we learned recently just by going to court, these things need to be notarized. And that came from a lawyer. A lawyer told us that. And then the CFPB told us as well. So we're going to dive into the CFPB tonight too. And the topic is adverse action, because we cannot be denied extensions of credit. And Melissa asked early, does this apply to the mortgages? Hell yeah, it applies to mortgages. And mortgage fraud is the beginning of it all. You know, a mortgage is not even supposed to be longer than 5 years. It's illegal for you to sign a mortgage and say you're going to pay something back for 5 years or longer. This is government. This is federal law. So if you sign in a 30-year mortgage, yeah, that's actually fraud. So y'all know I like to start off the night by setting our intentions and just kind of setting the tone, because we are unlearning to relearn, and that's just the name of the game. We have to literally just clean our minds out and wash away you know, all of the programming and everything that we were taught in school, because y'all know we're in our processes. Y'all know firsthand, like, this is opposite from what we were taught. So it's like, is this a conspiracy theory, or is this a, because at the end of the day, you know, this is truth. This is truth. And if you weren't taught this and you're just coming into this information, it can seem like it's a conspiracy theory. But I can share with you my personal experience, guys, because, you know, I've done what I've done using these laws, and I can stand before you and show you, like, you know, I settled, you know, accounts, auto loans, personal loans, just using law. My credit, you know, I've been able to do a lot of beautiful things with my credit. And even before I got to where I am now with my credit, I was able to utilize adverse action and get some stuff done too, just because I was denied credit, because an extension of credit, because I actually clear everything off my consumer report. And then I connected with Vance a couple of months ago, and he told me how to build my score. So anyway, I didn't have nothing reporting, nothing, not one account. So when I was trying to get a new car a couple of months ago, they were like, you don't, you your credit, you're not trustworthy. You don't even have credit. So I was like, damn, well, what can I do? So it took about, you know, 4 or 5 days to get some things done with no credit. But we can just walk in with our 800 score, no questions asked. And it's a respect thing too. It's like the way them people were talking to me because of my score at the time, talking to me like I was nothing and acting like it was impossible for me to get anything. Like, that shit made me feel like crap. Not really, but it could have. But it just made me look at them sideways, like, I can't believe you're talking to me like this because of my credit. But then I walk into a place with an 800 score, They like bowing down to me. I'm like, ooh, y'all are foolish. But anyway, we are bosses, right? We are bosses, and we came to literally pick up our crown in my dad's voice. I don't know if y'all watched that live I did with my parents the other day, but you know, my pops was saying, pick up your crown. And that's what we're doing. We're picking up our crown. So I'm going to start this night off, and y'all can join me. You can turn on your cameras if you want to, which you don't have to, but I like to really get the energy flowing within our bodies. And, you know, dancing is an ancient traditional practice that our ancestors used to harmonize, you know, with nature, to harmonize our mind, our bodies, and our souls. I'm teaching Phoenix how to balance her root chakra by dancing. So I want to do that with y'all too. Let's just, you know, invite in abundance tonight. We are unlearning to relearn. We are clearing space to be able to receive this information and apply this information and do what we need to do, period. So you can turn on your cameras to join me if you want. If not, it's cool. But I would like to create some balance and harmonize by dancing. Everyone knows this song. If you don't know this song that I'm about to play, I know that's right. Y'all came ready. Let me turn on my camera too. So y'all know this song. And if you don't know this song, I'm gonna have to ask you. So anyway, I'm gonna share my screen. Let's get up, let's get moving, y'all. Let's start inviting in abundance, because that's our birthright, abundance. Like, I'm not accepting anything less than. So we're gonna start cha-cha sliding tonight, because we sliding into freedom, into abundance. So let me share my screen so we can get these steps popping. And that's just what we're gonna do. So y'all better know this song. Let's see. Ma, can you hear me still?
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Take it back now.
Oh wait.
What?
All right, hold on.
Turn it out.
Hold on, wait. I'll start from the beginning.
To the left.
Okay, we could just start right here. Here we go. Let's run it back. Let's run it all the way back. Let's see here. All right. Let's see. Here we go.
Take it back now, y'all.
Okay, I'm going to take it back.
One hop this time. One hop this time. Reverse.
Ooh.
Reverse. Yeah. Slide to the left.
Hey.
Slide to the right. Reverse, reverse. Reverse, reverse. Cha-cha now, y'all.
Ooh.
Cha-cha again.
Yeah.
Cha-cha now, y'all. Cha-cha again. Turn it out. To the left. Take it back now, y'all. Two hops, two hops. Two hops, two hops. Right foot, let's stop. Left foot, let's stop. Charlie Brown. Hop it out now. Slide to the right. Slide to the left. Take it back now, y'all. Cha-cha now, y'all. Oh, yeah.
Hey.
Yeah, yeah.
Do that stuff. Do it. Do it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm out of here, y'all. Peace.
We out of here, y'all. All right, y'all. I just love to get the night started with some. I saw y'all with y'all moves. I'm here for it. Let me make my stop sharing my screen. I love that. Thank y'all for joining me. So, yeah, like, I just like to create, you know, just set the intention, set the tone. And when you get some good moves in and you invite in that abundance, mom with the baby, I love it. I know, right? Okay, y'all. So I love to dance too, Tish. Phoenix is so tired of me. She was like, mama, sit down. Like, why we gotta dance all the time? No, she loves it. So thank y'all for joining me. I'm gonna share my screen because we're gonna dive right in. So, you know, we got moving. And where are we at? Give me 1 second, y'all. Y'all can see my screen, right? Okay, good. Okay, so first and foremost, y'all, as consumers, we hold the power. I don't care what nobody else say. Us consumers, we hold the power. We are the most powerful piece on the chessboard. I cannot stress that enough. This is why we are vessels. We are spirits in a body, meaning we are vessels. Our body is the car. Our spirit is what we're carrying. So we have to actually operate, you know, as vessels. And when you sign something, when you put your signature on something, that, excuse me, that is your sign of nature. Signature, sign of nature. That means this is a sign that this person is alive. This is a sign that this person has the say-so, you know, in anything that we're doing. But it's crazy how these corporations just brainwashed us and made us think the total opposite. If I put my signature, my sign of nature on anything, this is the currency. This is the bag. So don't try to sit here and act like I'm putting in this application and you can't run me my bag. Like, where they do that at? I don't get it. So I want to start off by reminding you of your power. You know, we unlearn and to relearn, y'all. This is our time for freedom. You hear what I'm saying? It's our time for freedom. So we clearing out all that other stuff, that conditioning. Let's get it. So Equal Credit Opportunity Act. Remember what I told y'all about the credit reporting agencies not being government entities. They're corporations just like you and I. Let me point out something to you real quick. Let me just show you what I'm talking about. So I'm on the CFPB website right now, right? This is the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. Those credit reporting agencies, we used to call them bureaus, but they're not bureaus. This is the only bureau. Peep their website, y'all. Peep this website, .gov. Right there, .gov, right? Let me show you what Experian website looks like. What they say? Hold on, wait, wrong thing. That's Canva. What does that say? .com. Right? Not .gov. So there alone, there's a big difference in 1 second. Right there, big difference, .com versus .gov. So y'all hollering y'all the bureaus. Why y'all not on the CFPB website? Where y'all at? Oh, okay, cool. That's what I thought. So .gov, this is a government site. So I'm emphasizing that because the federal government, like the federal statutes do, like policies do not, right, sign of nature, where the one, we are the ones where the energy is flowing fixed. So whenever you are basically using a government website, you know, that's top tier. And policies do not trump federal government, period. They want to send me all these policies. All right, baby, your policies are pretty. But what does the government say? So federal government is what we are governed by. And if you want to get real technical and deep, because we are living beings, because we are the currency, because we are the bag, you know, we can even go back to, you know, I recently started learning about canon law. Canon law is the common law, like that's the law of the land. So, you know, even utilizing canon law, which there's some documents out there to really study this in depth. But again, like there are some things that really truly govern who we are. So I just wanted to point out .gov versus .com. So you want to really get, you know, your information from these sites that end in .gov. And when we start talking about negotiable instruments, we're going to use the treasury.gov site to back up what we're saying. But tonight is all about adverse action. So what I want to start off the night with is 12 CFR 1002. Government site right here. Government site. Equal Credit Opportunity Act. Regulation B. Right here, let's get into it. Regulation B protects applicants from discrimination in any aspect of a credit transaction, in any aspect of a credit transaction. Everything is a credit transaction. So Regulation B, which is the Equal Credit Opportunity Act, protects applicants. All right, cool. What is an applicant? Let's go to Law Cornell right here. Boom, applicant. Applicant, the term applicant. Can y'all still see my screen? Okay, so applicant, let's get into it. The term applicant means any person who applies to a creditor. Yeah, a creditor is like a financial institution. Creditor can be Chase, Wells Fargo, Navy, Federal, whatever. So, and remember, let's look at the little words that are actually big words. So when it says any, that means there's no statute of limitation. Any is any. So it doesn't matter. There isn't any, you don't have any exclusions, any. So when you're looking at the word any, just know that's there's no exclusions. And then the word or, remember it's either or means there's a choice. So when you see the word or, it means you have a choice and you can choose one or the other. So the term applicant means any person who applies to a creditor directly for an extension. All right, cool, we need credit, we need a loan, renewal, or continuation of credit. We want our credit limit increased. Okay, cool, or a continuation of credit, or applies to the creditor indirectly by use of an existing credit plan for an amount exceeding a previously established credit limit. So this part right here is pretty much an extension of credit. So, you know, this is a definition of an applicant. So I'm gonna go back to the government website and it says, you know, this protects any applicant. So we can be an applicant. If we apply for an extension of credit or we apply for, increased credit limit or something like that, this applies to us. So credit transactions and aspects of credit transactions include, remember, what is a credit transaction? I say every credit transaction is a transaction because if I am the natural person, technically I am the original creditor because I'm the original. I am the original. So I'm the original creditor because I'm the original man. You know, y'all came after me. The corporations came later, but baby, I'm the original. Isn't God the original? Aren't we gods and goddesses, kings and queens? We the original people. So, you know, you can interchange that verbiage when it applies to you. Remember, we have to wear many different hats. You have to be a consumer. Sometimes you can run it. You can run it and be like, I'm the original creditor. You know, you can be who you want to be, or one day you can be a lawyer. It really just depends on you, but just know you are the original, baby. Can't nobody duplicate you. So with you being the original, you cannot be duplicated. Nobody can. I saw something the other day. It was like, you can't copy me if I gave you the recipe. Like, that's it. You know, we can't be copied if we gave you the recipe. So these corporations are imitating us, and you just can't. You can't match my energy. So with that being said, every transaction is a credit transaction because I am the original creditor. You know, y'all came after me. I am the top dog. But anyway, we can get into that another day. But consumer credit, business credit, here you go, Melissa, mortgage loans, refinancing, open-ended credit, credit applications, standards of credit worthiness, denial of credit, servicing and collection, revocation, alteration, or termination of credit. So these are all credit transactions. So when it says that this Regulation B protects us of all of these different things, that's what it's covering. And so this regulation is basically saying we cannot be discriminated against. So if any of these are interests of yours or they apply to you, you can't actually be discriminated against. And this is the government. Why did the government put this out here for us? The government put this out here for us because we have been being discriminated against. And somebody told somebody, and somebody else told somebody else, and somebody in the government said, oh shit, let's run it back. Let's put this out here. Let's go ahead and publish Regulation B. Let all the consumers know, baby, we got your back. So when these places say you have a 400 credit score, we can't give you anything after you have already filled out your application, which is the bag, they're in violation and they're scamming you. So that's just the nature of the beast. So we just have to know how who we are and know how to run in here and get what we want. True story for me, true story. I got denied an extension of credit a couple months ago. I got denied an extension of credit. I needed a new car at the time. So I was looking at a couple of different cars. The very first car that I wanted, they were like, well, you don't really have a credit history. You don't even have any accounts. Like your credit worthiness, you don't have credit. So I was like, okay, so what does that mean? Well, I don't think that we can offer you anything because you don't, you know, fit our, I forget what they told me, basically denied me. So I was like, oh, okay. So this, I had to do this a couple of different places. One place actually banned me and basically accused me of fraud. So, I mean, that did happen to me and they told me don't come on their premises anymore, but whatever. And then the other places, I had to talk to people. I had to say, well, you know, I don't feel like you're competent enough to know what it is that I'm saying. So do you have a general manager? Do you have a district manager? Okay, fine. Can I please speak to the regional manager? And I had to really talk to a whole bunch of different people. Long story short, one of the cars that I wanted, they had originally denied me for an extension of credit. I said what I said, I escalated it. I talked to a lot of different people. I sent in some letters. Y'all, do you know they delivered a car to my front door? Delivered it. I don't live in the city. I don't. I live in the boondocks, in the middle of the woods. And I had a car delivered to my front door. I didn't want that car though. I just wanted to see what was gonna happen. So anyway, you just gotta know what you know. So moving forward, Equal Credit Opportunity Act, the government went ahead and put this out there for us. The most recent update came January 1st, 2018, not that long ago. And it's basically just letting you know, you can't be discriminated against. And so when I go back to actually La Cornell, where is it? Extensions of credit right here. So 12 CFR, same thing on the CFPB, but I like this one because you can actually click on additional, you can click on the definitions. So right here, same thing, rules concerning extensions of credit. So anybody that has, you know, an individual account or, you know, or you're trying to do something individually, it says right here, a creditor shall not refuse to grant an individual account to a creditworthy applicant. So a creditor shall not refuse to grant an individual account to a creditworthy applicant on basis of sex, marital status, or any prohibited basis or any other prohibited basis. So right here, first line, again, this is law, and it's saying that a creditor, which is a financial institution, bank, whatever, shall not. It says shall not. It don't say any, it says shall not. It doesn't say if, it doesn't say under circumstances. It just says point blank period, a creditor shall not. And that's just what it is. It doesn't give you another option. So an individual account to a creditworthy applicant. So you and I are the applicants. We just looked at the definition for applicant. We're applicants. We are creditworthy because what I do know is we validate our own self. We are creditworthy because we say that we are creditworthy. We are the originals. So I don't give a damn what score you're reporting on my behalf illegally. I don't care what you're saying. I'm creditworthy and nobody can validate my credit but the Most High. So if you are not the Most High, what are you talking about? Don't come at me sideways. And that's how you really have to be out here in these streets, guys. Like you have to run it like that because we have to know who we are. You got to walk in your power. You have to own it. You got to own who you are. You got to put your head up and just know and operate in that manner of power. Your credit worthiness is not based upon nobody but yourself. So you are a creditworthy applicant. And it doesn't even go into detail right here what constitutes creditworthiness. If there were any type of you know, regulations with creditworthiness, it would have given you another statute to go read to say, okay, well, this is what constitutes as creditworthiness. This ain't no hyperlink. How come they didn't hyperlink creditworthy? Because we validate ourselves. So if they wanted us to have an additional information about credit worthiness, baby, there would have been a hyperlink right here. Right here, there's a hyperlink right here. It says prohibited basis. It's letting us know. It's making it clear and plain as day. What is a prohibited basis? We cannot be denied credit based off of race, color, religion, national origin, sex, marital status, age, the fact that all, or right here we have a choice, part of the applicant's income. Right here, this is what I want to highlight. This is really the basis of this. In good faith, or the fact that the applicant has in good faith exercised any right. This is important. This is the most important part of consumer law. Make sure you're doing things in good faith. Like, and what that means is, in layman's terms, make sure your intentions are pure. That's layman terms. I use the terms good faith a lot because it's in the UCC, and I just try to like to use what the government is putting out there. But guys, if I can translate this into layman's terms, where are your intentions? What are your intentions? Are your intentions pure? Search your heart for any ill intentional things, and then say, okay, well, let me work on this area. Let me shine light on this dark place, and then let me move forward. Make sure you're doing things in good faith. And the fact that the law is basically also implementing spiritual laws, because in good faith is just intentions. You know, it just lets you know that they are also honoring us as natural beings. They're not going to be all spiritual and, you know, they're not going to talk the way that we be talking, but they're going to put it in our faces. In good faith, it just means intentional. What are your intentions? So anyway, basically you cannot be denied an extension of credit because you are credit worthy. So you are a credit worthy applicant. And secondly, if you move in with good intentions, you okay. So how do you exercise this then? Cool, you have the law in front of you, right? We looked at the government's. I pulled up the CFPB to let you know this is a government site, and it's coming straight from, a reputable resource. That's why I pulled that up. It's a reputable resource. I'm pulling up definitions so that we have clarity. So you're not just taking my word. I don't ever want anyone to take my word and run with it. So with that being said, right here, this is 12 CFR 1002. 0.7, and that's the first rules concerning extensions of credit. When you apply for anything, you are basically just applying for an extension of credit. And we know what we know. We're basically just using them as the middleman to get us our own money, because we don't know, we don't necessarily know how to tap into the Treasury direct account, which we'll get into that later. It's just really time consuming. More than anything, I wanna make sure that you know and you are aware of who the freak you are. So when we start moving like, the bosses that we are with this big energy, they gonna see us coming. So I just want us to be strapped up before we get there. So anyway, we have to know who we are. And again, here's just the law just showing that. That's it. That's why I'm just pulling it up. So I'm gonna pull up this template real quick, because this is the old one. I haven't updated it. Oh wait, let me finish this first. Where are we at? Okay, so what was the other point I was gonna make? Creditor should not refuse to grant, what was I saying? Oh yeah, so an extension of credit is basically when you go and apply for a new apartment, a personal loan, when you go apply for a mortgage. Guys, these are extensions of credits because, again, we don't have our Treasury direct account set up yet. We don't have our trust set up yet. We don't have our names trademarked yet. These are things that we have to have in place in order to really be strapped, like I said, because when you trademark your name, that's a different beast. When you have your trust and you are operating as your trust, because again, we are vessels, we're all vessels. So we can play that corporation game too by having certain things on file to move the way that we want to move. Phoenix, her name is trademarked. Everything about Phoenix is trademarked. So anyone that chooses to send her anything, even if it's just a coupon, like something, basically saying, hey, we have a sale. They have to be in business and have a contract to do anything with Phoenix. Like when Phoenix starts driving, that she cannot be pulled, her name cannot be ran unless that other corporation has a contract with her corporation to do business with her. She's trademarked. She is a trust baby. Everything that she is a foreign entity. So if you want to talk to Phoenix, you need to have a contract with her to do business with her, because she moves. She is moving transactional, because everything is a transaction. I'm gonna give y'all an example. I took this course before I trademarked her name. I took this course during the pandemic. Y'all know Harvard and like all these other colleges were allowing you to download these free courses or whatever. And everything is such in alignment in my world. I ended up taking this course. I don't know why. I know why now, but it was free and it was Harvard. So I was like, oh, I can get this little course knocked out. They're gonna send me a certificate that says Harvard and all of that. But anyway, it was about trademarking. And when I took this course, it gave an example about McDonald's. McDonald's trademarked everything on their menu. And I'm gonna do a class on trademarking too later. But I took this course, it was a 7-week course. And one of the examples that I'll never forget is that McDonald's trademarked every item on their menu. And there was a company that, I don't know, I can't remember where they were located, but there was a company that decided to call something, Big Mac. They used the term Big Mac for something. I don't know if they had opened up a new, I cannot remember, but I know that the restaurant called an item a Big Mac. Do y'all know that McDonald's sued this company for $2 billion, B as in boy, because they used their name. They use the Big Mac, and McDonald's owns the Big Mac. So essentially they sued them for $2 billion. And they won that because they trademarked Big Mac. You can't go use Big Mac without McDonald's permission, and don't let McDonald's find out because they're going to sue you. So same thing, Phoenix, don't send Phoenix no bills in the mail. Don't use her name on nothing unless you have permission. So, you know, that's how we have to really be moving. And as, you know, we can do that now. It's a couple of days to trademark something. It's just $250 to register it. I'm going to do a class on it. Conversation for another day. Mama, do not let me run off at the mouth tonight. I'm trying to stay on topic. So adverse action, let's get back into it. So we just read the definition of adverse action. We went to the government site. You know, we saw what they were talking about there. We went ahead and got clarity on any additional, definitions that we weren't sure of, like account, what is an account, who is a creditor. We needed clarity on an applicant. It's hyperlinked. So when we click on it, it's hyperlinked. That gives us additional information on what's going on. Creditworthy was not hyperlinked, meaning you decide what's creditworthy. You decide whether or not you're creditworthy. And then that's that. Again, the credit reporting agencies are not bureaus. There's only one bureau. They are not government entities. Any websites ending in GOV is a government entity and they are a reputable source. If it ends in .com, it's not that reputable. Adverse action, let's get it. You went and applied for something. They responded to you saying, we can't extend you any credit. What you're gonna do is you're gonna take that letter. You're gonna take that letter, the adverse action letter, as evidence. You're going to take that letter as evidence and you can simply write them back. You can simply respond to their offer because going back, recap, remember guys, everything is contracts. That's why the trademarking is so important. Everything is contracts. And when you're dealing with a contract, it's offer and acceptance. All right, cool. I went in, applied for an extension of credit. You said I couldn't. That's an offer. So I'm going to send you a counter offer. What you want to do is basically just send a letter. Everything needs to be done. And you can only communicate with dead entities by letters. So that goes back. I don't know if I said it on the call or if I said it to someone else. I don't know. I'll be talking too much. But anyway, the corporations are a corpse. They are dead. The corporations, they're dead. So when we are operating as corpse, we're operating as dead entities. And the only way you can really communicate with a dead entity is in writing. Example, if I go to my mom or my dad and I tell them that a ghost told me something, gave me a whole message, a ghost, I had a whole conversation with a ghost, and they'll be like, okay, they already think I'm crazy anyway. So they'll just be like, okay. But if I come to them and show them a letter that a ghost wrote me and the ghost put their signature on it, then they will believe me. So when we're doing business with these corpses, these dead entities, with these, you know, empty vessels, we got to have proof. So yes, put that in writing for me. Let me go ahead and prove that you are, you know, saying what you said. So again, if you have a conversation with a dead entity or corpse, have it in writing. You need proof. Because if I just go and relay a message that I had verbally to someone, I'm trying to tell them what happened, they're going to be like, okay, you had a conversation with a ghost. All right, that's what they said. All right, cool. But if I come with a letter and I'm like, look what they said, then it's like, oh, shoot. All right, what you going to say back? So it's just like that movie also, The Sixth Sense, like the little boy was writing on the mirror to the ghost. They were communicating that way, but it was in writing. That's how they were communicating, through writing. So that's how we kind of have to think about it. I hope that makes sense. I hope that wasn't a corny example. Oh, I love the explanation. Thank you. So that's it. So you'll write them back. They gave you an offer. Okay, I accept your offer. Here's my counter offer. Right here, I, the consumer and natural person, was denied credit by the company's name when I applied for whatever you applied for, $25,000. Adverse action against the consumer is 100% against the law. Why does this template say that? Because we went to the government site. So this is law. So it's against the law. So this is a fact. According to the Equal Opportunity Act, remember, we just talked about that. The Equal Opportunity Act can be found in 1691C or 12 CFR 1002. I like to use the CFRs a lot because the CFRs is the code of federal regulation. So I like to reference that, but you really don't have to do too much of anything. You are liable for criminal liability. So what that's saying is, I'm just breaking this down. So basically, if anyone violates the law, if we are operating in these people's jurisdiction and we run a red light, they say, oh, you broke the law. Guess what? We are liable for, we are criminally liable, right? Because we broke their law. So if these corporations are breaking the law, they are criminally liable. So that's why you're saying this in your letter. You're letting them know, like, hey, I'm fully aware of the law. I know what's going on out here. And I know that if you break this law, I know that I can sue your ass. So that's basically what you're saying to them. You letting them know, I'm not stupid, y'all. I see what's going on. I just want you to know that if you violate this law, the game over. So that's what that's basically saying. You want to make sure you highlight the company's name. I have proof that I was discriminated against by the company's name due to the response I received. In this case, you would take that written response, attach it to this letter, and that's your proof. Always keep the original copy for yourself because these people like to play games. So you're going to keep a copy for yourself. And then you're in violation of USC 1681M. That just basically goes back into the whole 15 USC 1681M. Same thing, this is adverse action. So requirements of a user's consumer, requirements on users of consumer reports. So right here, if any person takes any adverse action with respect to any consumer, you and I are the consumers, that is based in whole or in part of any information contained in a consumer report, the person shall. So what that basically is saying right here is, if someone is discriminating against you based upon something that's in your consumer report, then you need to, and then the steps are here. I'll let y'all go read that yourself. I don't want to spend too much time reading something. I want it to be study material and we can talk about it later. But these right here is telling you right here, if there's any adverse action taken, this is what you do right here. You can call, but always put things, man, this is a really good read. Really, really good read. So 15 USC 1681M. I'm gonna go back to the template real quick because I'm gonna try to wrap up. I'm on limited time. Is there a time frame after receiving the adverse action letter? Immediately, but 60 days. You want to respond within 60 days. If you got an adverse action letter 2 years ago, I really don't know. Let me see if this will tell me. I don't really know what the time frame is. I'll find out. 30 days right here, not later than 30 days upon 60 days. So I know it's 60 days, but like as far as responding to something from a couple of years ago, I really don't know. I know there's no statute of limitation to fraud and stuff like that, but typically like what I can speak on right now, 60 days, respond within 30, you got 60 days. If you had a little situation that came up and you got denied something, go apply again, let them deny you again. And then use the most recent letter. That's what I would just say. That's what I would do. Just go reapply, let them deny you again and use the most recent letter. But it's 60 days, 30 days. You want to respond within 30 days, but there is a 60-day grace period. So furthermore, oh, this is real good. We talked about this in another class. Everyone on this call should have access to every single replay. If you get a chance, go look at the unauthorized use of billing of Social Security, your Social Security card or your credit card. Go watch that replay. I don't think it's that long, maybe like an hour or so, 2 hours. But right here, key point, my Social Security number, AKA my credit card, was used. And because I received no benefit, baby, that's fraud. So that means that you used my credit card for whatever reason you used it for. I didn't get anything in return. So there was no benefit. So this is definitely proof of fraudulent activity. Look, y'all, this definition is the unauthorized use of a credit card. What's that, 15 U.S.C. 1602? Let me see something real quick. Well, y'all can just go watch the video. Yeah, do that, because I'll be in this thing all day. So unauthorized use of credit card is when you, credit card, hold it right here, so it's 1602p right here. So the term unauthorized use, this is basically use of a credit card by a person other than the card holder. Who is in possession of the Social Security card? You are. That's your card. You're in possession of it. Even though it doesn't belong to you, it belongs to the government, it's yours. It's in your possession. Example, I love giving examples because it helps me. I like clarity. Phoenix, my daughter, she is the authorized user of my credit card. So it's my card. When I get those statements in the mail, I have to pay those balances, not Phoenix. But Phoenix is a card holder. So she can run up that card. She can. And I can't say it was fraud because she is a card holder. So if you are using your card, your credit card, your social, and you see inquiries on your report, people running your card, you didn't actually get any benefit from it, that is fraud. So in my case, Phoenix is a card holder, but she doesn't necessarily own that account or own that particular credit card. That's my credit card, but I gave my daughter permission to use it so she can do what she wants to do. However, if someone on the street walked up to our car and stole her card and used it, and I saw some transactions that we didn't benefit from, I'm like, Phoenix, is this your transaction? She says, no, and it wasn't mine. Then that's unauthorized use of credit. So when we see these inquiries from, we went inside of, let's say, CarMax, trying to get a new car. Next thing we know, we see inquiries from Santander, from Chase, from American Credit Acceptance. Like, what? I did not walk into your establishment and give you permission to run my card. And if you run in my card and I have this inquiry, then where is my money? So anyway, just going back to that. So I'm not going to get too much off topic. Y'all can go watch this video. On the dashboard, y'all know I talked about this in depth. Unauthorized use of credit card. Just running the credit card definition real quick. Credit card, any plate, any coupon book or other credit device existing for the purpose of obtaining money, property, labor, or services. Your Social Security, that is a card. That is a card. It says any card. Remember the word any, that means that there's no limitation, any card. It can be your Social Security card. It can be your life insurance card. It can be any card. So don't forget that, y'all. So just going back to the template, let them know, like, y'all, this is fraud. You tell them you can't extend me my credit, but I gave you my credit card. So what happened here? So let them know. And then it just goes into, you know, right here. If your company fails to make any reasonable procedures to resolve this matter and compensate me for the use of my credit card, I will indeed make you criminally liable for all actual damages pursuant to. And, you know, these two are government. Oops. These are laws that state, you know, you are, this should be $1,000 per violation, period. All right, that's it. And you just send them the letter, let them respond. And that's that. And so everything is offer and acceptance. If you send this letter, it's not a one and done. Let them respond to you. That's what's happening. We're trying to fix our credit, do all these things. But when they send us back a statement saying it has been verified, we're like, damn, all right. No, how did you verify it? So in this case, you know, okay, I ran it. You see that you use my credit card. And if you come back basically saying that you didn't break the law, because I've seen that too. They didn't do anything wrong. Guess what? You have your original adverse action letter. You have that denial letter. So you have that proof. You have that example. And if you got to take it to civil court, that's just what you have to do. Do not give up. Don't stop there. Get compensated for your damages. You know what I mean? So it's like, you know, do your part and not give up. Don't let them play you. You cannot be denied no type of credit. All you have to do is put this stuff in writing, put it in the mail, send it to them, have your certified receipt, your tracking numbers. Those are witnesses as well. And let that be the reason. Like, we don't need to be afraid of paper. They denied you. Okay, tell me why you denied me. Oh, you denied me because my credit. So this is discrimination now. Oh, okay. Do y'all know I saw this case study? Roland versus, oh my goodness. Roland versus, he settled for a big amount because of discrimination, extension of credit. Dang, Roland something. It'll come to me in a minute. I recently read it. Vance sent it to me. It'll come. So anyway, the case law that I read, it was on Pacer. It basically was this man, he settled because of discrimination. Same thing, adverse actions. Man, I read that article. I was like, you better go get your money. It was so great. I'm gonna have to find it and upload it. So rolling verse something. Let me look at my text messages real quick. But yeah, so, you know, we're going back and forth with them. At the end of the day, guys, just know who you are. Know you are powerful. Know that that little no that they sent you is not the end of the world. Just write them an adverse action letter. Wait for their response. If they said that they did not break the law, you go ahead and gather up all of your evidence. That original, keep your application. Anytime you're applying for something, y'all, keep your applications. Ask them for a copy to make copies. Make them keep the copy. You keep the original because that's the money. So you have your application, a copy of your application. You have the adverse action letter. Okay, now you got to take it to the next step. You want to include the currency. You want to include the operator of currency. You want to include the attorney general. You want to include the CFPB because remember, they put these statutes out here. So you want to include them because you want to let them know, hey, CFPB, I just want you to know this little creditor out here is breaking the law. What you gonna do about it? So, you know, you want to include them and just let that be the reason. Like, you just can't give up in the middle of the game. Finish that game and you will see results. You will see remedy. So for those of you that I'm working with one-on-one with your credit, I was telling you guys, you know, it's a process. So we just have to know. I meant to ask, what websites do you go to? Wins? Pacer, P-A-C-E-R. And then sometimes I just Google like this. I'll show you. Like this lady in New York. So I'll just Google like, let's see. If I could type. Okay, so I'll just Google like experience settlement, right? Just to see what comes up, like what comes up recently. So like right here, like the company settlement of the FTC. Sometimes I stalk Google, but there is a lady in just little keywords, because you know, if you type in certain stuff, It'll pop up. Let's see. $13 million settlement. Just weird stuff. I'll just type in weird things just to see what pops up. And then I'll go from there. But I use PACER, P-A-C-E-R. Just stuff I just be reading. I just be on Google just reading stuff. So, but there was one particular, I think I showed y'all this before. This lady, she settled for $13 million. Let me see if I can find it. I forget. Oh, she settled for $13 million because, thank you. You're welcome. PACER, P-A-C-E-R. I think it was Equifax. Let me see 1 second. Does anyone have questions though? You can unmute yourself and ask any questions that you may have.
I have a question, Zainab.
Okay.
So what, like, can we just apply for any amount then? Like, does it have to be some kind of reasonable amount? I mean, can I just go in and apply for like a $500,000 personal loan and then obviously get denied and then do this adverse action letter?
What are your intentions? I mean, you can, but what are your intentions? You know, like, you can definitely apply for any extension of credit, but you know, when you move in good faith, what are your intentions behind it? Because everything is energy. So I'm only bringing that because sometimes things are in alignment with our intentions as well. So if we're not pure and moving in good faith, it might not work out the way that we expected it to, but legally speaking, yes. You can go apply for any extension of credit. You cannot be denied an extension of your own credit. The reason why I say that is because federal law states that, you know, if you are, you cannot be denied. You are a credit worthy applicant for one. You are a credit worthy applicant and you can't be denied based upon anything that it mentioned. So legally, yeah. Logically, yeah. But at the end of the day, what are you doing that for? Is it legit to, you know, put your family in a beautiful home and, you know, create a sacred space? Or are you just like, you know, I'm not saying that to you directly because I know that you have a pure heart and like you really are, you know, doing this for freedom. But at the end of the day, you know, we always want to make sure our intentions are in a good space. But the answer is yes. Yes, 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 yes.
Thanks. That's really helpful. Thank you.
If anybody else has questions, just unmute yourself and you can ask, even if it's not related to adverse action, just ask anything. I haven't really responded to the questions in the Telegram group because I just haven't really been in there the way that I just haven't. But if you have questions that I didn't see in there, you can ask here too. It's fine. This is an accountability call. We're here to support each other more than anything. But questions relating to anything that I may have experienced with, you can 100% ask now.
Okay, I had a question. It's Tish. my question is, okay, so earlier this week, I drafted a letter for the hard inquiries.
Okay.
And I posted the letter to the what is it called? Our group chat.
Yeah.
And I just wanted feedback on if I did it correctly or if I needed to make some changes to it. So it's there if anybody gets a chance to look over it. I wanted to just get some advice on if I needed to make any changes before I sent it off.
Okay. Yeah, I'll go look at that. And I love dealing with inquiries because those are actually like 100, everything is fraud. Truthfully, but inquiries are like the prime example and evidence, firsthand evidence of fraud. Because if you don't have an open account with any of them inquiries on your report, if you don't have an open account, that's clearly fraud. If you did not benefit from that swipe, then where did that money go? So I love inquiry letters, and you can get inquiries removed in about 24 hours. Like if you even call, I screenshot the amount of time I was on the phone with Experian. I called Experian, I was on the phone with them for a little less than 15 minutes. I screenshot that time, but in 15 minutes I had inquiries removed just because they know what's up. So I'll look at your letter and I'll give you some feedback, but you can't really go wrong at all with the inquiry letter because that is firsthand evidence of fraud. So, and when
I kind of did it in the format of a conditional acceptance letter.
Oh, okay. Okay. Let me look at that. Okay. I'll check that out.
Okay.
I have a question.
Hey, sis.
Hey. So I wanted to know, what do you feel like the role of the CFPB does? Because I filed several, you know, CFPB reports, and it seems like they're just an in-between person. Like, you know, the company will respond, and then at you know, once they respond, then the case is closed. So I didn't really, I guess I don't really know, like, what's the point of the CFPB reports, because they are just like a middleman, I guess. Mm-hmm. What do you think?
Yeah, so they are definitely a middleman. When you're dealing with the CFPB and you're submitting those complaints, it's just a matter of you putting things on record. So the purpose of the CFPB, for me, the way that I use them, I put it on record. Because when you are dealing, you know, doing anything in commerce, you want to have proof. For example, like if you wanted to file divorce with your husband or something like that, and you put it in the newspaper and you publish it in the newspaper for 3 weeks, 4 weeks at a time, and that your husband doesn't respond, you have that on record that I have tried to resolve this matter and he didn't comply. You know, that's just one example. If you have a court case or anything, you're putting it on record. And going back to me establishing my trust, I had to put that on record so that you know, anything that I acquire, any assets that I transfer into my trust, it is on record that this is owned by, you know, this trust. So dealing with the CFPB, yes, they are the middleman. They do protect us. Sometimes they can take matters into their own hands and rectify situations. But at the end of the day, you have a record that you submitted a complaint to the CFPB. They did not comply. You can take a copy of what you submitted and, you know, go ahead and CC the AG, CC the OCC, the FTC, CC everybody and file a claim. Like, that's what it's really for evidence purposes. Even if you go and file identity theft, you know, if you do that with the credit reporting agencies, they'll be like, well, did you file a complaint with the FTC? No, but I'm about to. And so you just want to basically do it for record keeping or bookkeeping, because we're accountants. Remember, we are lawyers. We are, you know, the controller of our estate. So everything that we do in good faith, and we want to keep a record of it. So if the CFPB is not working in your favor, still record it with them for additional evidence, and just get comfortable with filing those suits. Like, you know, just get comfortable with like saying, okay, let me print off this. And I have evidence now, and I'm going to take it to that level, and I'm going to do what I need to do if y'all aren't complying. But it's just record keeping, literally record keeping. So
yeah,
filing your complaints with them and just kind of be ready to take it to the next level if need be.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Does anyone else have any questions? I'm gonna check the chat now. I needed this pep talk. I'm so glad you're here with us. Can we apply for something? Okay, you already asked. I'm listening. Pacers, this, okay, so no more questions. This case study, I can't find it, but I'm not really looking for real. But it basically, it was a woman in New York. I think I shared it in the last group, in the last class. Let me look at it. Let me just Google real quick. I think it was Equifax, just to show y'all what I'm talking about.
While you're looking for that, I do have another question.
Uh-huh.
Have you done a class or course on how to build the trust, or what, is that something that you'll be doing in the future?
I'm going to do that in the future. It's so simple and easy. It's a template okay. That you follow. But when you're doing a trust, you want to, it's just a matter of having your affairs already in order.
Paperwork.
I'll do something in the future with that because the way that I'm moving now, I still want to, you know, assist in every possible area that I can. But right now, like, my focus really is mamas and kids. So I want I just want to be able to assist with setting up the children, and that includes the trust. So my first courses will be geared towards mama and kids and just setting up our families, setting up our children so they're straight. So it's really about them for me now. So that'll come really soon. It won't be in this setting. It won't be in this setting, but it will. It will come.
So, okay. Sounds good. Thank you.
But it's just a template. I can even just post my template, and you can kind of get a small. I'll put it in the Telegram group. You can see exactly what I'm talking about, and you just this. And this is my irrevocable trust. My living trust. My irrevocable trust is a lot. It's different. My foreign trust is different, and it's just a lot more detailed. And then just filing it. You know, it's so easy to do, but we're not used to it. But I actually share the template for my revocable trust in the group, so you can see what that looks like. But moving forward, I just want to be with my mamas, with all my mamas. That's all I want to do. And that it looks different than this. So I found something, I think. My screen not sharing anywhere. So right here, like, this was Equifax. So this was an $18 million settlement for Equifax. And this is something I found on Pacer, but I felt like this ABC News article was way more detailed because it was talking about how she was denied credit. You know, back in 2009, like she submitted a complaint. You'll see this on Pacer. I'll post this in the group chat. But, you know, she was denied credit, and it was because of her Equifax report. So she did what she did. She received a copy of her report. She, she filed her CFPB complaint, y'all. She had all her evidence. She did what she needed to do. She did those steps after being denied credit. And what was she awarded? She was awarded $18.6 million. Like, don't play with me, because she knew. You know, she knew what was up. So I'm gonna actually post the Pacer, the original PDF, into our group chat. But this was an ABC article that I came across that later made me go study some more. Like, what do you mean she was denied credit based on her Equifax report? And what steps did she take as far as adverse action is concerned? And so what do you recommend? I'll answer your question real quick, Deja. So I went and read her full study, and that's $18.6 million. You know what you can do with that? So, and this was, you know, not that it was, you know, a little bit 10 years ago, but still, you know, we're still experiencing this today, and we're even more aware of what's going on. So now we have more energy to even run this. So to answer your question, Deja, conditional acceptance. I love a conditional acceptance letter. As it relates to adverse action, I would use something similar to the template that I shared. But at conditional acceptance, that's my baby. I love a conditional acceptance because I'm never arguing with you. I'm always going to, you know, remain in honor. And I'm on your side. So another example, like, I don't want to fight with you. I'm way too bougie and cute to fight. Like, I'm on your side. So let's run it up together. And us doing this, we need to be on the same page. And in order for us to be on the same page, I'm sending you this conditional acceptance letter. And this conditional acceptance letter is just letting me know, like, okay, this debt is what's owed upon conditions. These conditions are gonna give me the clarity that I need to make sure that we are on the same page. When it comes to adverse action, you can say I conditionally accept, you know, your denial of credit or your extension of credit to me upon, you know, these parameters. But would that be my go-to with this adverse action letter? No, I wouldn't. Moving forward, like, if they came back with another letter saying, well, so I wouldn't do it the first time. That wouldn't be my first response. If they did respond saying, well, we didn't do anything wrong, you would say, okay, well, I will accept the fact that you didn't do anything wrong and that you didn't break the law. If you can prove to me that the law says that you can discriminate against me, if you can prove that there is a law that says you can discriminate me or you can deny me credit, then I will accept your plea that you did nothing wrong. So the initial response, I would just hit them with a standard letter, and their response, I would conditionally accept it. So I hope that helps. I love conditional acceptance. I've been able to do some really cool stuff. with conditional acceptance, but we are going on 10 o'clock Eastern, and I do hope, you will have access to it. What do you recommend for credit card utilization without them closing the account? Same thing. If you are asking for a continuation, or just go back to the law, use that verbiage. Is it a continuation of credit, meaning you want, you know, a higher limit? Then same thing, just send them a letter, apply for an extension of a continuation of credit or a higher limit. If they respond to you saying we cannot do this, you basically send them an adverse action letter. If they say we didn't break the law, we're not going to follow what you're asking us to do, then you will send them a conditional acceptance, and then you just go from there. It's just logic. You know what I mean? It's logic, it's offer, it's acceptance. And does that sit well with you? Is that okay with you? If it's not, send another letter. We're just communicating with the corpse. That's all. Just communicating with corpse. And if you know who you are, you know whose you are, you know your power, you'll get what you need. You'll get what you want. You'll get what you deserve. And that's just the name of the game. So thank you for reminding me to record this, Deja. I will post this onto the dashboard as a replay if you want to go back and reflect on anything that was stated in this call. We'll do this again next week. If nobody has any more questions, I'll definitely, you know, touch base with each of you. But for now, that's all I have for y'all tonight. I hope that, you know, you were able to find some value in anything that was shared. You have the law. Don't take anything I said for face value. Go study. And you got this. You do. You really do. So if nobody has any more questions, I'm going to say goodnight. When I end the call, I'll post it to the dashboard and we can just go from there. We love you back. We love you too. All right, y'all. So, and Tish, I'll go look at your letter now. I'm about to go nurse. So I'll look at it while I'm nursing and I'll respond. And if anybody else has questions, go ahead and put it in there because I'll be on Telegram in just a few. But for now, I love y'all so much, and I'll talk to you later. Good night.